My name is Greg Fox, and I've been at WESH TV since May of 1987, and I've been in broadcast journalism for 41 years.
So let's go back to the era of the shuttle. You were here for many shuttle launches. What was it like to be a reporter covering the shuttle era?
What it was like covering the shuttle era was strange at first for me, because when I got here in May 1987, the shuttle program was grounded because of the disaster with Challenger the year before. So we were very much in working in the Brevard County Bureau and covering NASA. We were very much in the mode of what's the next test? What's the next safety procedure? What's the next thing they're going to do to make sure that astronauts both go up and come back safely? So a lot of that was going on. Then we finally moved into the relaunch of the shuttle program, and it was as exciting as ever. It was exciting because people knew that NASA had invested a great deal of time, money, and technology in protecting astronauts going forward. And so we were at every launch. One of the things that we often did was to be able to go into the chopper, and that was a real benefit for me because we got to be over the Indian River, look at Launch Pad 39A and 39B, see those shuttles go up. And of course, all of that changed after 9/11. Then there was a closed airspace for obvious security reasons after that. And so much of our observations when we were not actually near the VAB, not actually nearer the launch pads over at NASA, was to be along the Indian River and just be with people and see what they were seeing and enjoy what they were seeing right next to them.
What was the feeling of the crowds? I mean, you were kind of on crowd control, if you will, or watching with them. What was it like to be amongst Central Floridians or anybody who came to watch a shuttle?
For the shuttles that I witnessed from along the Indian River, there was an incredible excitement from people. Some of them had never seen a launch before. You think it would just be a lot of the people who live along the Space Coast, but a lot of people came from other countries. They came from other states. They built the big trip of the year around the idea that they would see a shuttle going up, and then they could read leading up to it, what are the astronauts doing on board? What are the experiments they're doing? Are they taking up cargo, satellites, whatever it is? And they would show up with their telescopes and their binoculars, many of them purchased just for this trip. And they would, especially in the colder weather months, you know, they'd be bundled up, sitting out there for hours because they wanted to be right up against the railing or close as they could if they were at Jetty Park or some of the other viewing areas that are along A1A. They wanted to be there in front. So they would be there for a long time, for hours, just sitting there, some of them shivering in those cold weather months.
Tell me about the Shuttle Columbia mission in 2003. What do you remember about the lead up to that mission?
One of the things I remember about the last flight of Columbia is that I had the job of speaking with a couple of students who were visiting. They had an experiment on board. One of them was Palestinian, one of them was Israeli. And this was a strong moment, really, if you will, in national relations as well as science. Their experiment was to send crystals into space and to see how they might develop without gravity and try to get a handle on how the universe was formed. And I talked to both of them. They were extremely excited. They wanted to see the experiment succeed. More than anything, they were thrilled to see the first Israeli astronaut going up aboard the shuttle Columbia. And so they were there with their binoculars, and they were there watching as it went up and thrilled that their experiment was going into space.
There was sort of extra attention on this mission, right, because of the special astronaut you mentioned?
Ilan Ramon. He was a colonel in the Israeli Air Force. Part of the excitement about the idea that Israel was sending its first astronaut into space is that they were also joining the shuttle program. They were joining a crew that was going up, not only carrying experiments, that was exciting, but the fact that you had the first Israeli astronaut in space had a lot of people talking. It was a lot of the conversation that was going on as people were watching on that chilly day.
So take me back to launch day. Explain your assignment, what the weather was like. I mean, really walk us, paint a picture of that morning.
Mm-hmm. My job on the morning of the launch on January 16th was to really get an idea of the crowd bigness, if you will. And they were lined all along the Space Coast. I remember it being really cold. I had a turtleneck on and then a heavy shirt, and before that, coats for earlier morning live shots. Again, people were just lined up, waiting for it to go up, hoping it would go up. Everybody knows when you go to a shuttle launch, you know, is it going to go? Are we really going to see it? And of course, as soon as the countdown went to zero and the shuttle went up, people were cheering. And of course, then they felt that immense wave of pressure coming across the Indian River. And it just punches you in the gut as you're seeing the shuttle go up.
What do you remember thinking and feeling about that shuttle launch? Was anything remarkable, or was it another shuttle launch?
What I remember about this particular shuttle launch is that I had before then not covered a launch of Columbia. Okay, so that was, you know, the first one that launched in 1981. And so I was finally getting a chance. I had seen Discovery, I had seen Challenger, and I hadn't seen Columbia. So I really wanted to see it go up. I know they all look the same to people, but they're not the same. As you see launch after launch after launch, and you cover them over the decades, you kind of sense a personality in some of these shuttles. And so I was excited just to be there for that. One of the things I remember about the launch on January 16th is that there were an extraordinary number of children. A lot of times you see adults, you see retirees, people who can spend time coming down to the Space Coast and waiting a day or two, or maybe booking a week's stay because you might have a delay in a launch window. There were an awful lot of kids. And we talked to a number of kids that were, you know, 8, 9, 10 years old. And for them, they had never seen any kind of a launch. They hadn't seen a rocket launch. They hadn't seen a shuttle launch. So we talked to them, and of course, as children would be, they're trying to, spend some time waiting for it all to happen while the adults were all tuned into their handheld radios. Some of them had portable TVs. You had the kids, they were running around playing games until, you know, mom and dad or their aunt and uncle said, come on over, it's about to happen, it's about to happen. They're like, is it really going to happen? Yes, it's going to happen. It's going to happen now. So stand right here, or let's get up on my shoulders so you can get a look at it.
Did the people in the crowd sort of come to you as the media, you know, do you know what's going on? Is it really going to happen?
On launch day, a lot of people come up to us because they're looking for the latest information. I mean, they're hearing what's going on the radio, and for those people that had portable TVs, they could actually kind of keep track on whether or not there was a launch delay, if there was a hold. So they would come up to us and say, what are you hearing? And we're hearing the same thing that you are. We're waiting for it to go up and hoping that it goes up. And so far, things are looking pretty good for that today. So that helped them with a little bit of optimism. That's a lot of the reason. It's not just people saying, hey, put me on TV. Hey, interview me. I want to talk about the Shuttle Columbia. They came up because they wanted the latest information.
Okay, so I want to move forward to February 1st, mm-hmm. 2003. Where were you that morning? What were you doing?
On the morning that all of us learned the worst possible news, as a Boy Scout leader, I was in the Ocala National Forest, on the edge of it at the Boy Scout camp in Central Florida, with a Cub Scout pack. From my church, and there were a dozen of us, and as soon as we had heard this news, the first thing that happened in camp was that we all gathered around the flagpole in a salute to the astronauts who, as far as we knew at that point, had lost their lives, said some prayers. We had some decisions to make because I was being paged at Channel 2 to come in. I mean, every reporter, every photojournalist it's all hands on deck. You got to come on in. So I was asking the other Cub Scout leaders and the boys, and I said, what do you want to do? I have to go to work. And they said, you know, something like this, we just can't enjoy it anymore. So we're all going to leave. And that's when I headed into work, which was a day then heading out to the Space Coast.
So before smartphones, how did they get in touch with you?
The way they got in touch with me about what had happened was by pager. I mean, you're talking about 2003. We didn't have really good cell phone signals in the forest where we were camping. And so I got a page, and it was blunt, you know, come to work, shuttle Columbia.
And walk me back just a minute. How did you hear what happened to Columbia?
The way I heard about this while we were camping in the woods is that other scout leaders had been milling around camp, and they had said, have you heard? Have you heard? At that point, I hadn't heard the news of what had happened. And that's when I ran back to my tent, and I checked my pager, and then I saw the message, and I knew. Time to go to work.
Leaving the National Forest and coming into work, what was that, the process of getting ready to cover one of the biggest stories of your career?
What this was like while I was packing up a tent and getting my son Kevin and getting sleeping bags together and loading the car and heading out of the woods, it would be an hour before I could get back to my home and try to get ready and go in. I'm thinking in my mind, you know, could this possibly have happened again? You know, we had just had Challenger in 86, and you thought that they had worked out everything that could possibly happen. We knew about the foam coming loose from the booster and striking the side of the shuttle. But we thought that they were working on that. I mean, the presumption was that they were working on the heat shield and everything was okay. So while I'm driving out of the woods and driving away from the campground and thinking about all the things that could happen as I'm preparing to get to work, I was thinking, didn't they get this figured out? How could this have possibly happened? So there was a lot of disbelief in my mind the whole time. It was a lot of driving in silence.
Talk to me about coming to the station. What was the scene that you walked in through? How did you get your assignment on what you'd be doing that day?
All right. When I got to the newsroom, of course, everybody was in full-on emergency response mode. How are we going to cover this enormous story? And it wasn't that it was a big story for us. It was a big story for Florida. It was a big story for our nation. And in particular, it was a big story for all of those scientists and engineers and rocket mechanics and everybody who works along the Space Coast who dedicated their careers to making sure something like this doesn't happen. And so when I came in, everybody was scrambling. The fortunate thing is that we had a game plan at that point because it took me nearly 2 hours to get to work. Everybody had assignments, who was going to go to Texas, who's going to go out to Brevard County, who's going to be talking to potentially family members, friends of not only the crew, but people who worked with the crew to try to get a sense of what was going on. My assignment that day was to go out and talk to just regular folks. What are they hearing? What are they talking about? How are they reacting to the worst possible news? And that was in local restaurants, it was in churches, it was in people on the street. And they wanted to share their stories. And so we did a lot of listening that day.
Tell me about the people you met, what they told you.
When we first got to Brevard County, the people that we met first were in a restaurant. And of course, on the TV, everybody was seeing the latest reports. They were glued to it. You can imagine if there were sports bars along the Space Coast, there was nothing about sports going on. This was the story. This was the story for the entire country, for the world, that was going on. And so everybody was glued to it. A couple of guys that were sitting at a table, just trying to enjoy some lunch or early dinner, you know, they said, yeah, I'm an engineer. You know, I work on the shuttle program. And the other guy there, he said, I'm a mechanic. You know, I work on shuttle and rocket launches. I see a lot of the stuff that comes back, you know, and we have to evaluate it. How did that hold up in space? What's going on there? And these people very much felt like family members had been lost. They didn't have to know the crew personally, but they all worked together in a family sense to make sure that safety was priority and that these people came back home.
Talk to me about the sort of impromptu church services and things that popped up that day.
Yeah. One of the other places that we went in Brevard County were to several churches to see some of the services, impromptu services that had been arranged. Because people very much in their strong faith wanted to express in prayer. They wanted to do that in community, not just alone. I think this was very much a not be alone moment. I think people wanted to be in community with others so that they could not just share what their thoughts were with people they maybe knew or didn't know inside of a church, but also to pray together, to try to find some kind of sense out of what was going on, try to find some kind of relief about what was going on. And those were solemn moments.
Did you have any opportunity to see Dan's coverage?
During some of the breaks when we were not shooting our stories to prepare for a broadcast at 6 and 7 and 8 and 11 o'clock that night, I had a chance to watch Dan Billow's explanation of just how this could have happened. And it showed his experience from decades of covering space, what an expert he really was. It was comforting to see because he knew what he was talking about. He explained both what happened on the launch that led to ultimately what happened in the re-entry from orbit. And I got a sense that I'm really getting it. I understand this. And I have to believe the people who are watching Dan also get the sense that he's telling it like it is. This is the way it happened, and that this was a tragedy that we could have seen in the days since the launch, and how it couldn't get fixed. I think the thing that really struck me about how Dan was explaining this from both the time in which the section of foam broke off on launch, caused the damage to the orbiter, and then could potentially cause a problem on reentry. I think I got a sense, hey, couldn't they have done something? Could it have been prevented? And he explained all the reasons why, that they really couldn't do something, and really it was a situation where they were hoping reentry would be okay. But his experience leading up to this moment made it possible for not only me, but everybody else who was watching him hour after hour after hour to really fully understand the scope of what happened.
What was it like, you know, even just around afterwards? You know, was it like a somber
feeling?
Yeah, very much in the weeks and months and really years that followed this disaster, I think we kind of got a sense, hey, we've had a disaster involving Challenger, 7 crew members lost. We've had a disaster involving Columbia, 7 crew members lost. I think we got a sense and maybe a lot of feedback from people talking to us too, that they thought that the shuttle program really needed to come to an end. It was expensive. Now it was dangerous. And I think people at that time were sharing with us. And what I remember are conversations with people saying, we can't keep doing this. We have to do something differently. The cost is too high, and we don't want to lose another human life.
Does it feel like it's been 20 years?
I don't know. The short answer to that is, yeah, it does kind of feel like it was 20 years. You know, it's still fresh in people's minds because of how terrible it was. What I hope is that going forward, we have learned so much about what went wrong, that going forward, everything we do that takes us into space goes right.
Dan mentioned yesterday the memorial service that they had at Kennedy,
mm-hmm.
and how it was as much for the astronauts as it was for Columbia, for their ship that they lost. When you were talking with people that day, NASA employees, did you get a sense that they felt equal loss between, yes, the men and women who were on board, but their life's work into this ship?
Mm-hmm. I remember very much that as people were sharing their stories on that day, that they made me realize that this was an investment in their life and the amount of time that they had put in. Yes, there was a loss of life, but there was this deep connection that I have spent my career to be able to send people into space. This is what I do every day, and I call it a job, I call it a career, but it's also their passion, and they shared that. And so for them, this was a double loss in a sense. We lost 7 lives, and we also lost a big piece of what they do for a living to be able to send people into space and for us to learn more about space. All the experiments on board, the satellites that are often deployed, the cargo that goes up. I mean, you know, you could look at the shuttle as an observer who's not connected to the space industry and say, that's a cargo vessel. It just happens to go into space. It's not out on the ocean. For these people, this was the future. And for them, a bit of the future stopped that day. And you could feel that heaviness in their hearts.
You remember, like I do, that like some of the first idea that something had hit the wing of the shuttle on launch, we were hearing from Dan Billow before we were hearing it anywhere else.
Yeah. And I don't know that to be a fact, but I think I think he was one of the first. Look, I know Dan probably recalls that he was the first one to say, this is not good. We should be seeing the shuttle now. We're not seeing it. That's not good. What I remember about launch day, and then Dan Billow fairly quickly after that saying, hey, look, there's a big chunk of foam. And you hear the word foam, you think it's something like styrofoam. Okay, you're talking about a big, heavy chunk. And at the incredible speed and force with which the shuttle is lifting off, smashing into the orbiter, Dan Billow recognizing right away that's not a small problem. That's a big problem. And I think we all were thinking about that as they were conducting the business of the space flight itself during the mission and leading up to the point where Columbia was supposed to come home. Dan was on it, and he's really the one who, in our minds, sensed that this could be a bad, bad finish to this mission.
Did we take for granted that everything was going to go right, and so that it didn't become this big event anymore? Was there a sense of that?
I think what caught many people by surprise, and I go back to the Challenger disaster. Leading up to that point, everything seemed kind of normal. Shuttles go up, shuttles come down, everybody is safe. After Challenger, of course, that changed dramatically. But again, leading up to Columbia, we had had so many successful launches that it was probably normal for a lot of people to feel a complacency, you know, worrying about their daily activities. You know, I'm on a camping trip. Other people are planning vacations, maybe not reading the newspaper or watching the news, and all of a sudden it just hits them. You know, that's a shuttle. There are seven lives on board. They're not coming home to their families. And I think that was a huge wake-up call for people.
This is my last question, unless these guys have anything else, but just, you obviously have to go into reporter mode, mm-hmm. journalist, you have a job to do, but I know you, and I think that you were probably a person first, right?
Mm-hmm.
You're with your son, you're with children. Take me back to that moment of being a person and a parent when this tragedy hits.
As we were gathering around that flagpole to do a salute to the crew of Columbia and to say a few prayers, you're noticing on the faces of all the 8, 9, 10-year-olds that are standing around, and then afterwards talking to, you know, my son talking to me, the other boys talking to their moms and dads. They're trying to get a handle on exactly how big a deal this is, okay? And I think that the thing that struck me is that they realized that it wasn't just some rocket that didn't come back to Earth. Remember, as Cub Scouts, one of the things we did was build and launch rockets. And so they had that passion. Now they were learning something different, that there were people on board and that they aren't coming home. And for some of them, I have to believe that was their first experience with a discussion with a family member about death. And so we walked away from that flagpole and that gathering pretty much in silence, because there was a lot to digest there. And so it was rattling, it was shaking to a lot of people.